guys, I want to talk, first of all, I mean, there's a lot of stuff going on in the world, a lot of stuff that's really crazy. First of all, in Toronto, there's been a trial that has been, a lot of gawkers, a lot of people have been preoccupied. They say, according to some journalists, it is one of the highest profile trials in a long time in Toronto. The disgraced radio TV personality slash singer, Gomeshi, was found not guilty on all counts. Apparently he's got another thing he's got to deal with in June, but there was protesters when he came outside. I thought his lawyer did a great job, and I thought the Crown did a terrible job. And I watched some of the trial, that the witnesses did not come across credible. Your views, guys?
All right. And obviously I defer to Bill with his law degree, but I mean, I think, Frank, everything you said is accurate. It seemed like an overwhelming task for the Crown attorney, because as it turns out, some of the testimony from the complainants and a lack of, obviously it seems there's a lack of physical evidence or DNA, it seemed like a pretty questionable case off the top. And then when you hear the reports that two of the complainants, or at least two of them, were texting each other, sounding almost allegedly in a conspiratorial type way, like, let's get Gomeshi. I mean, really, it almost sets it up to fail before they begin. It didn't seem like, based on the comments and the testimony that came out, that the Crown attorney prosecuting this case had much of a chance of succeeding in terms of getting past, they had to create, there was a defense, as you mentioned, Gomeshi's attorney did a brilliant job. It seems she created more, Bill Waters, more than reasonable doubt, and that's what's required.
The fact, go ahead, Billy, and I want to respond to what he said.
The fact that it was one of the most highly publicized cases in Toronto for a long time also jeopardized the Crown attorney, because he had no choice but to try it. But he ain't stupid, man. He questioned those complainants. He went through that stuff. He knew before he was going in there that he had at least three dandies that, if he was lucky, he wouldn't get charged with contempt of court. It was a...
Let me ask you something, Billy, because you're very perceptive. Do you truly believe that the Crown did it because of peer pressure and media pressure that he charged Gomeshi? Our version of the grand jury is a pretrial. Do you believe that they charged them because they had no choice because of media pressure? But do you believe that the Crown going in knew that he did not have a strong case?
Well, that's my point, Frank. I think that they didn't have a very strong case, and I give credit to the Crown, whomever that was, that he would recognize that way before anybody else. And he was afraid that if he didn't try it, he would get a bad reaction from all women.
Well, forget about all women. I think anybody that has been sexually abused or abused in any way should not in any way be deterred from coming forward. But you need to know that if you're going to come forward, you have to tell the truth, and you have to stick with what your allegation is. What I believe the crack was, and Billy, I agree with you 1,000,000,000%, you're very perceptive, and that was my point. And the biggest problem for the Crown was that the witnesses were extremely not credible.
Yeah, they looked, Frank, it looked to me like they were very ill-prepared.
Well, I think that they were prepared, but they weren't prepared to have a lawyer who was very smart, who was better prepared, and the questions she asked were crazy. Crazy accurate. And it seems to me that Gomeshi kept a lot of the information, like he was paranoid that this would come up one day.
Yeah, well, I just want to jump in, Frank, and ask Bill. Bill, do you think, because as we were talking about, and as I mentioned before, and everyone's been reporting on the texting going on between, at least if I got it correct, two of the complainants pertaining to Gomeshi, Bill, I'll just ask you your best guess. Would the Crown have been aware of that before they went to court?
Absolutely. It's called disclosure. It's not admissible if the Crown or either side does not know what either side has.
Yeah, okay. All right.
So, Bill, if you want to fortify that or verify that, you let me know.
I don't. All I'm saying is that if they were texting between one another about Gomeshi, it certainly would have to be brought forward. If they were texting one another as friends, I don't think that had to go. But as far as texting one another as conspiratorial partners, that's what we're looking at, and that's probably what the Crown said once he found out. He said, what the hell am I into here?
I don't think it has anything to do with that, Bill. I think that what happened is once you get cross-examined by either or, depends what side you're on, and you start to change your fucking story, your credibility of your testimony is in jeopardy. And if your testimony is in jeopardy, then you as a witness are not a witness anymore.
Yeah. No, I agree.
You're an asset for the other side.
Well, that's why as the case went on, it was apparent to all those interested in it that it was no longer a case. It was just a presentation of evidence. Let's get it over with.
Exactly. And that's why it was not a long, drawn-out trial, because once the defense lawyer got what they wanted, which was inconsistency, that's what the job of the defense lawyer is, to get inconsistency in the original testimony of the statement that was given. Because that testament, once it's given it to the police, it's carved in stone.
Yep.
So so everything, that's the foundation of the defense or the plaintiff, is that statement. Once you go to court and they're all using and referencing that statement, and you can you change your story, or you have no remembrance, or something else comes out that is completely opposite of what you swore, then you're in trouble.
Yeah. Also, unless I missed something, doesn't sound like there was a whole lot of physical evidence or DNA evidence.
Well, I don't think anybody disputed the fact that they were together. I don't think anybody disputed the fact whether it was Gomeshi's side or the complainants that they were together and they had physical relations. I don't think that there was any. I think that the argument was whether the physical relations were forced, and you know, there's some texts going back and forth between the complainants, which shows a little collusion there, that they're going to get this bastard. Then there's some of the complainants after the fact, talking to him in an amorous way.
And then some of them were getting back to Gomeshi, saying, let's get together. Now, that could either have been to create more evidence. I don't know what their purpose was.
The judge didn't buy that.
No. That whole case, Frank, was so flimsy. And you make a good point. The lawyer for Gomeshi was sharp as a tack.
She's one of the best in the business. But here's my point, guys, and I don't want to stay too long on this. Gomeshi was found innocent, but I think he still lost.
Yeah. This big time.
Well, I think he lost. He lost his credibility as a journalist. He lost his. He lost. He's not the Wonder Boy, the Superman of CBC anymore. He's done. He has become a social pariah, and that's the irony of a trial like that. You're damned if you win, and you're damned if you lose.
Yep,
that's 100% right.
So he's better off to just pack his bags and move on someplace else.
Yeah, and I don't think it'll follow him everywhere, Frank.
He was tarred and feathered in public. He was exonerated, so he's not going to jail, which is, that's a big lottery ticket. But you know, his personal life and his demons have been put out in public.
I don't know what he's going to do to make an income. I mean, the only thing I think...
he'll make an income. Maybe he'll get a reality show. I don't know. I don't want to hypothesize. I'm just telling you that, sometimes you win the battle, but you lose the war.